In the nation's capital Yaoundé, calling on the government to secure the release of some 300 incarcerated teachers that were orchestrating a protest demonstration between yesterday and today in the nation's capital. Also ahead, we see how the journalism profession has become life-threatening to practitioners in the two Anglophone regions of the country as a result of the socio-political tension rocking the northwest and the southwest regions of Cameroon. In this newscast, we get the reactions of some media practitioners in the northwest region of Cameroon. Also ahead, poor leadership is the root cause of the Anglophone problem that has been going on for more than 2 years now, says Honorable Joshua Osi, is going to be reacting in the second part of this newscast. Those are headlines. Stay with us. We shall be right back. Good evening to you, ladies and gentlemen. We thank you so much for joining us in this edition of the Primetime Newscast on Equinox Television. Let's begin right away here in the economic capital, Douala. Life has returned to normal in Kassala Farm neighborhood and also at the Fampo Market after the demonstrations of inhabitants yesterday that led to the closure of several stores, an incident which occurred yesterday, Tuesday. The Kassala Farm's residents retaliated after several homes were broken into by security forces and some local inhabitants tortured, purportedly by men in uniform as well. Simanji Kangebre was in that said neighborhood. He compiled the following report.
The body of a human being transformed into a drawing board by the military at the Kassala Farms neighborhood, Douala 2 municipality. Eric is one of the unfortunate inhabitants at the Kassala Farms who was beaten by some military men Tuesday morning after 8 cartons of drugs disappeared in the course of it being offloaded at the Fampo Market. As I returned from work midnight, the military stormed the neighborhood, beating everyone and used beer bottle cap on my body. At the brigade, the woman asked for pardon and I was told to come with a medical booklet. Not too far from the residence of Eric is the house where another victim of the military raid at the Kassala Farms resides. The landlord tells us,
"Now so then they enter, no, now so down boy the gaffer, but they go enter for down boy, no, so now so they tap at down there."
The boy nicknamed Chinois was the most hit of the raid. His door was forcefully opened before the 8 military officials pounced on him. Chinois is now at the military hospital, according to his landlord.
They said that apparently for the continue, it don't spoil. Chinois told me that for me to grab. They said they don't tell if for garrison military.
Meanwhile, activities have returned to normal at the Fampo Market that was paralyzed the whole of Tuesday.
And the basic education minister, the minister of secondary education, that of higher education, other administrative authorities and the grumbling teachers who went on strike Tuesday met today in the nation's capital, Yaoundé, but the meeting was simply boycotted by some of the teachers. It was within the context of the 7th ordinary session, or the 7th session of the Interministerial Committee, charged with examining and proposing solutions to the problems of the teachers who have been without salaries for several years now. During the meeting, the teachers' trade unions maintained that at least the government should ensure that the 300 teachers arrested on the day one of the protest should be released before the deliberations can begin. The union leaders said that the teachers must be released before the deliberations continue. Some have criticized the fact that the committee's 6 previous sessions are not yet yielding fruit up to now. It should be noted that the dozens of the striking secondary education teachers were arrested yesterday as they were striking against the accumulated salary arrears. Three of 300 of them were arrested, according to some of the teachers that met during the meeting today in the nation's capital. Few of the teachers continue the strike action that was today in front of the Ministry of Finance, the Secondary Education Ministry, and also in front of the Ministry of Employment and Vocational Training. And it was as a result of protest that some activists of the Anglophone problem were arrested. That was several months ago in the northwest and the southwest regions of Cameroon. Manchu BBC and other detainees of the Anglophone crisis that are due to appear in court tomorrow in the nation's capital, where the case between them and the state of Cameroon is due to resume. The information was confirmed today by one of the lawyers defending the Anglophone activists who have been behind bars since the start of the socio-political unrest rocking the two Anglophone regions of Cameroon. The case has suffered countless adjournments after the release of the 55 persons arrested earlier in 2017, including Barrister Akbobala, Dr. Fontem Neba, and Aya Polabine. One of the preconditions for the return to normalcy in Anglophone regions of Cameroon is for the release or is the release of all those that have so far been arrested in connection with the crisis. Would Manchu BBC and Co. Finally have their verdict tomorrow? The answers only tomorrow's court hearing would tell. We now talk about the situation tomorrow's court hearing would tell. We now talk about the situation of journalists in the northwest region of Cameroon practicing journalism in that part of the country, and also in the southwest region, is now a veritable nightmare, an uphill task, but more than a nightmare and equally a very dangerous activity. This is because of the worsening socio-political and security situation in the two Anglophone regions of Cameroon. Journalists are permanently at risk of being attacked. We spoke to two journalists in the northwest region of Cameroon, Chove Low and Emmanuel Fokum. They are going to be recounting their day-to-day ordeals in the following excerpt.
Normally, when you operate in a crisis zone, it will necessarily have an impact on your performance, meaning that it's sometimes very difficult to get to your sources because of declared ghost towns, because of fear, and so news gathering becomes not the best thing. Sometimes you work very often using the phone calls, or you have to sneak through the quarters to get to your sources. In fact, it's not been helping. The crisis have not been helping matters. We are caught between the web of the pros and the cons. We are in a situation where a journalist is supposed to be truthful. It's supposed to present the facts as they are. But we are in a situation where, in a political situation, I know that since politics is not about straight lines, politics is about crooked lines. To me, that politics is not about straight facts. In which case, somebody is saying something, somebody is objecting, and nobody is presenting the facts as they are. And where you find yourself in a situation where the sources are scary, the sources themselves don't want to speak to the press, but the press has to report. The press has to entertain, you have to inform, and has to educate. So at one minute, you just get to do with the inspiration of your training, you have to inform, and has to educate. So at one minute, you just get to do with the inspiration of your training as a journalist to decipher what to tell the public. So it is more about experience here. And experience will indicate that at one moment, you should use stock information to inform. Because when you go one way, you are attacked for being for, and one way you are attacked for being against, and every day you are caught up in the web, which makes reporting very difficult in times like this.
It is not actually easy, because before you even get to report as a reporter, many people now with the Android phone and with the social media, they have already had what they have. And when you are coming now as a journalist, who is bound now to give the truth and to give what you have investigated, people want to judge you from what they are getting from the social media. So it is not easy as a reporter during this crisis. And you are even targeted when you want to give them the truth. They want you to take what they want and what they have heard or read or seen from the social media, which makes the work very difficult.
The difficulties of media practitioners in the Northwest region of Cameroon in the wake of the socio-political crisis rocking the two Anglophone regions of the country. Now, would the Women's Day celebration be different for women of Binshua community based in the Southwest region of Cameroon after the previous edition was affected by the Anglophone crisis? This, as they have so far been told to be agents of peace and unity in the entire society. The message was re-echoed by Barrister John Kamini as he was donating Women's Day fabric to some of the women recently. Derek Jato was there. He tells us more in this report.
The 2018 Women's Day built up in Boya subdivision.
If I have my bottle of drink, I will take it peacefully with a joyful day. If I have my bottle of drink, I will take it peacefully with a joyful day, with a joyful heart.
On Women's Day,
I'm feeling so happy. I'm very, very happy.
These women are from Binshua, a village in Donga Mountain Division, resident in Boya subdivision. A subdivision that has known no peace for over 1 year now because of the Anglophone crisis. And today, Comfort Barrister John Kamani, a son of Binshua village, is preaching for the peace to come back through women.
Most of the women are encouraging their children to be disciplined. It's in that light that I thought that I should encourage them, thank them, and give them a strong push, because they are the backbone of the modern community.
And donating to them the 2018 Women's Day fabric was his own way, as a notable of that line, to thank these women for being true pillars of the family.
And if there is discipline at home, there is discipline in the street, and there is discipline in the whole nation. And in that light, I decided to offer all the Binshua women these beautiful 2018 Women's Day fabric, so that they can celebrate with all the women of the Republic.
To Tashe Michael, one of the founding fathers, Kumfo's gesture is a rare privilege.
Looking at what is going on now and what has been done, it's a big privilege to the Barakians, which is the Binshua village in the Donga Mountain Division.
We now take you to Dibeng. Dibeng is a village in Yabasi of the Nkam Division in the littoral region of Cameroon, where roads and electricity as well as potable water are practically absent. It is a very difficult situation for local inhabitants. As Catherine Kone tells us in this report.
Dibeng, one of the 48 villages found in Yabasi subdivision, Kam division of the littoral region. The litany of problems faced by the inhabitants of Dibeng are bad roads, electricity, and lack of potable water. The roads in Dibeng are untarred, dusty during the dry season, and muddy during the rainy season. Road users complain the dilapidated structure of the road is just a tip of the iceberg. The village, according to the inhabitants, have been abandoned. They decried not only the poor state of the road, also frequent electricity cuts, limited water supply, among other social amenities. Among the problems faced by the locals in Dibeng is the absence of traditional ruler. Their chiefdom have been for several years without a ruler, a situation which arose conflict among the inhabitants on who to rule the village. After several fights, a chief was finally elected for the people of Dibeng. The new traditional ruler of Dibeng, recently elected, will have the downy task of seeking solutions to the plight of the people. Dibeng, even though faces several problems, is equally one of those villages in Yabasi subdivision producing increasing number of food. It is also rich in agriculture.
That is the situation in Dibeng in Kam division of the littoral region of Cameroon. We now talk about security that has been reinforced in Batibo as a search for the missing divisional officer for the said locality, as well as the social affairs delegate in the northwest region of Cameroon, intensifies. It is one of the fallouts of yesterday's crisis meeting in the locality that was chaired by the senior divisional officer for Momo. The circulation of motorbikes has been strictly restricted in several parts of Batibo. As we speak, the measure to authorities is to limit the rate in several parts of Batibo. As we speak, the measure to authorities is to limit the rate of attacks, and fury is the word to describe the state of minds of local inhabitants that actually spoke to Equinox TV's team of reporters that were on the ground. We saw how local inhabitants were simply indoors and they were complaining about the situation of security in Batibo at this point in time. It is as a result of the current socio-political crisis rocking the two Anglophone regions of Cameroon, as we see in the following report. Batibo is one of the subdivisions in Mumu. It is located 40 kilometers from Bamenda and about 100 miles east of Nigeria. It is also situated along the Bamenda-Mamfe Highway and known as the economic, social, political and cultural heartbeat of the Mugamo-speaking people. This is the area where two administrators have in 2 weeks been picked up by unknown armed individuals and taken to an undisclosed destination. In Batibo, life has not been the same again for the population since the kidnapping of the divisional officer for the said locality on the 11th of February and the escalation of the Anglophone crisis. During a tour through the neighborhoods, doors were closed even in the afternoon, and the streets were empty. Only few persons could be spotted.
They don't go see where that thing they start, how they be tip, they can't take D for fee for 11 February. Since that day, they be taken, so people, the gendarme, they be there for your army, then they be there for you. So all picking, they run them. Now all of you,
This grandmother explains that her son fled the village for safety. She and other locals further recounted how their economic and social activities have crumbled as a result of the prevailing situation.
You know the chop flop, you know if you be steady for place, you want to do something. You see the run on, you know what you have. You must fear. So therefore you have no way for you to manage life. Sir. What day? We know they will we go buy tea for the ghost time for chop. We begin there. And how we would they meet and banya? We must around die. You know, get brother and sister. Now all of we will they compound. A palaver money. We know they get with money.
They are the only Batibo based residents who accepted to talk to Equinox TV's team of reporters. Their desire is for the return to normalcy in the area and in the entire northwest region of Cameroon. To the administrators, the tension would have been minimized if the population worked in close collaboration with forces of law and order.
They feel how they many people they come, they shoot that gun, they want to shoot, and so they say they don't want to see the boy picking. No, do her. They gave for run. If now you see gun, they should show you should run. As they told, they say they want a man picking them. Time for some mommy where they for us where it passed me said. Because some money will be put up for a basket for move and buy things that they move on.
But the fuel in this part of the northwest region of Cameroon is general. We now talk about activities ahead of the 8th of March, the International Women's Day. Civil society organizations that are stepping up the fight. Civil society organizations that are stepping, against heart diseases. It is a health problem that affects a good proportion of Cameroon's population today, especially women. And this explains why the purpose of the ongoing month of Women's Heart that is taking place in some parts of Cameroon today. Let's have the details with Babla Jonathan.
Close to half of Cameroon's population is infected with cardiovascular diseases. In Cameroon, we can note that we have around 35 to 40% of population who have hypertension. And in that prevalence, we have to note that the women are more than men. About cardiovascular diseases, the women are the most affected by that group of diseases.
And this is why civil society organizations are stepping up the fight against such diseases. Sensitization is their main tool.
Professor Daniel Lomugo, who is the chairman of the Cameroon Heart Foundation, decided to create a program named Alerte Rouge, where the aim is to fight against cardiovascular diseases in the women. This year, we have an innovation by the month of the heart of women, le mois du cœur de la femme. And this month, then we will be used to make the screen, to sensibilize, to inform, to inform the woman about, to know about their risk factors, about cardiovascular risk factors, and not only the woman, but the society.
Respecting preventive measures and other medical prescriptions is of cardinal importance.
A preventive measure is good for her to know their risk factor first. Second, it's good to reduce our salt consumption, to eat much fruit and vegetable, to move much, like dancing. It's proof, it's scientific proof that dancing can to move much, like dancing. It's proof, it's scientific proof that dancing can protect your heart.
These simple tips, medics say, will take cardiovascular diseases from high risk to low risk and save many from damaging and deadly results of diseases that destroy the heart and consequently the entire human system.
As we said earlier, we are going to be talking about the accept or the outing of the first vice president of the Social Democratic Front, who is now the flag bearer of the said political party ahead of Cameroon's presidential elections, that has said that the root cause of the Anglophone crisis is poor leadership. He indicated that it is impossible to take the second step before the first, that is looking for the solution to a problem that has not yet been identified by the government of Cameroon. In that regard, Honorable Joshua Osi holds the opinion that putting the matter on the table and engaging real dialogue is imperative and even indispensable. This is what the Social Democratic Front is looking forward to do when it takes over power through the ballot box that's going to be this year, 2018. He was speaking to Equinox Television shortly after he was elected the flag bearer of the Social Democratic Front ahead of the 2018 presidential election in Cameroon. Let's hear him in the following interview and excerpt.
The problem of the Anglophone crisis is the absence of leadership in Cameroon. There is no miracle solution for any crisis in the world. The solution to any crisis is to make it such, as we say down at the coast, you cannot clean a fish in a bag. You need to put it on the table to be able to clean it. So if you don't put the problem on the table, you cannot get a solution. People seem to say that time for dialogue is over. Let me make this abundantly clear. There has never been a time in the history of humanity where the issues, even as the Second World War and the First World War, etc., were solved uniquely by violence. Issues are solved by negotiation. Issues are solved by discussions. Issues are solved by dialogue. And for that, it is imperative to have leadership, because only when you have leadership do you have followers. The problem in Cameroon is that we don't have a leadership, so nobody follows. The problem is that Mr. Biya does what he wants and nobody cares about what he says. And that's why everybody tries to do what he or she wants. The fundamental problem we have as Cameroonians, be Anglophone or Francophones, but I will say here especially Anglophones today, is that we have no party to talk to. There is nobody, there is no door we can knock at. And you find yourself in a situation which seems flawed as per what is expected by the population, based on the culture, based on the history, based on tradition. And there is absolutely no way you can start a discussion to try to correct or at least be heard, that somebody listens to you and you tell your story and you say why you are disappointed, and then we move on from there. You know, the first problem when somebody is annoyed in your neighborhood, in your family or whatever, is listen to the person. Even if the person has no point, listen to the person. And only after that can you tell the person your points are not valid. But in Cameroon, it doesn't happen. When you get annoyed, you get a bullet. And you cannot solve a problem that way. So I think the first step to resolve the Anglophone problem is to change the presidency, who sits in the presidency in the Republic of Cameroon. The presidency, who sits in the presidency in the Republic of Cameroon. That's the first step that can be taken, because Mr. Biya is not capable today to release all the political prisoners he has. He's not capable today to release all the innocent people who are in prison just because they were on the streets at the wrong time of the day. He is not capable today to engage in dialogue, because he doesn't even talk to his own ministers. How come will he start talking with people he feels they are all terrorists? And Mr. Biya is not ready today to engage in anything that will be able to make, to empower the average Cameroonian, and I underline Cameroonian, because it's not just an issue that you'll find in the Southwest and the Northwest. You'll find that same issue all over Cameroon. It's just that the Southwest and the Northwest has a history of, I would say, community organization, a history of political awareness that our brothers on the other side of the Mungo did not experience through their colonial times, because you had a hyper-centralized government put in place on that side of the Mungo, so they're used to what is happening there. They don't feel that it is something that shouldn't exist. And so I repeat what I'm saying, the only way you can solve this problem is to have a new president who understands the problem and who is ready to discuss about the problem in the presidency. And it is not about destroying the nation Cameroon. It's not about destroying the borders. It's about readdressing the form of the state fundamentally, and the position of the SDF that I now represent as flag bearer is that we want a federal state. The number of states will be decided by the Cameroonian people, will not impose it on them. Okay? And we believe that the first solution, Cameroonian people will not impose it on them. Okay? And we believe that the first solution in Cameroon to solve this problem and many other problems, the fundamental problems of development, etc., is federalism, is to give back the power to the people. And you can only do that through federalism. And that's what we stand for. And so we believe that the first thing that we will work on at the level of institutional changes is to propose a new constitution to the Cameroonian people that takes them away from the hyper-centralized form of the state into a federal republic, in which you will have federal capital territory, and you'll have a certain number of states that will have their own powers. You have a three-tier devolution of powers. And why not even go further and even think about putting in place a semi-parliamentary regime as well, in order to reduce the powers of the president, because that is the problem in Cameroon. From a pit latrine that is built in a primary school somewhere in Babanki, up to a mega project that costs $500 billion, everything goes through the desk of the President of the Republic. From the director of the nursery school, the teacher at the nursery school, right up to the minister, everything is appointed by the President of the Republic or by delegation, and that has to stop. So if we do not address that issue, we simply are going nowhere, and we have a golden opportunity to solve the Anglophone issue once and for all in the next 6 months without any drop of blood. It's simply for people to go and register get registered at their local Elecam offices, get the voter's card, be ready to vote and vote for change. And let the new leadership that comes in place give a new offer to the Cameroonian people. And you'll see you'll solve a problem without having to go to violence, without having to abduct people. And you'll see you'll solve a problem without having to go to violence, without having to abduct people, without having to close businesses, without having to burn streets, and without having to kill anybody. And it is possible, and the SDF is out here to offer it. Thank you.
Honorable Joshua Osi, the first vice president of the Social Democratic Front and flag bearer of the said political party ahead of the 2018 presidential election. That brings us to the end of this edition of the primetime newscast on Equinox Television. Viewers, we thank you so much for joining us. Wishing you a blessed stay in the company of our programs. Until you meet again, goodbye. In the nation's capital, Yaoundé, calling on the government to secure the release of some 300 incarcerated teachers that were orchestrating a protest demonstration between yesterday and today in the nation's capital. Also ahead, we see how the journalism profession has become life-threatening to practitioners in the two Anglophone regions of the country as a result of the socio-political tension rocking the northwest and the southwest regions of Cameroon. In this newscast, we get the reactions of some media practitioners in the northwest region of Cameroon. Also ahead, poor leadership is the root cause of the Anglophone problem that has been going on for more than 2 years now, says Honorable Joshua Osi. Is going to be reacting in the second part of this newscast. Those are headlines. Stay with us. We shall be right back. Good evening to you, ladies and gentlemen. We thank you so much for joining us in this edition of the Primetime Newscast on Equinox Television. Let's begin right away here in the economic capital, Douala. Life has returned to normal in Kassala Farm neighborhood and also at the Fampo Market after the demonstrations of inhabitants yesterday that led to the closure of several stores, an incident which occurred yesterday, Tuesday. The Kassala Farm's residents retaliated after several homes were broken into by security forces and some local inhabitants tortured, purportedly by men in uniform as well. Simanji Kangebre was in that said neighborhood. He compiled the following report.
The body of a human being transformed into a drawing board by the military at the Kassala Farms neighborhood, Douala 2 municipality. Eric is one of the unfortunate inhabitants at the Kassala Farms who was beaten by some military men Tuesday morning after 8 cartons of drugs disappeared in the course of it being offloaded at the Fampo Market. As I returned from work midnight, the military stormed the neighborhood, beating everyone and used beer bottle cap on my body. At the brigade, the woman asked for pardon and I was told to come with a medical booklet. Not too far from the residence of Eric is the house where another victim of the military raid at the Kassala Farms resides. The landlord tells us,
"Now so then they enter, no, now so damn boy they gaffle, but they go enter for damn boy, no, so now so they tap at damn view."
The boy nicknamed Chinois was the most hit of the raid. His door was forcefully opened before the 8 military officials pounced on him. Chinois is now at the military hospital, according to his landlord.
They said that apparently for the continue, it don't spoil. Chinois told me that for me to grab, they said they don't tell if for garnison military.
Meanwhile, activities have returned to normal at the Fampo Market that was paralyzed the whole of Tuesday.
And the Basic Education Minister, the Minister of Secondary Education, that of Higher Education, other administrative authorities and the grumbling teachers who went on strike Tuesday met today in the nation's
community. And donating to them the 2018 Women's Day fabric was his own way as a notable of that line to thank these women for being true pillars of the family.
And if there is discipline at home, there is discipline in the street, and there is discipline in the whole nation. And in that light, I decided to offer all the these beautiful 2018 Women's Day fabric, so that they can celebrate with all the women of the
to Tashi Michael, one of the founding fathers, Kumfo's gesture is a rare privilege.
Looking at what is going on now and what has been done, it's a big privilege to the Barakians, which is the Bishwa village in Kambodonga Mountain Division.
We now take you to Dibeng. Dibeng is a village in Yabasi of the Nkam Division in the littoral region of Cameroon, where roads and electricity as well as potable water are practically absent. It is a very difficult situation for local inhabitants. As Catherine Kone tells us in this report.
Dibeng, one of the 48 villages found in Yabasi subdivision, Nkam Division of the littoral region. The litany of problems faced by the inhabitants of Dibeng are bad roads, electricity, and lack of potable water. The roads in Dibeng are untarred, dusty during the dry season, and muddy during the rainy season. Road users complain the dilapidated structure of the road is just a tip of the iceberg. The village, according to the inhabitants, have been abandoned. They decried not only the poor state of the road, also frequent electricity cuts, limited water supply, among other social amenities. Among the problems faced by the locals in Dibeng is the absence of traditional ruler. Their chiefdom have been for several years without a ruler, a situation which arose conflict among the inhabitants on who to rule the village. After several fights, a chief was finally elected for the people of Dibeng. The new traditional ruler of Dibeng, recently elected, will have the downy task of seeking solutions to the plight of the people. Dibeng, even though faces several problems, is equally one of those villages in Yabasi subdivision producing increasing number of food. It is also rich in agriculture.
That is the situation in Dibeng in Nkam Division of the littoral region of Cameroon. We now talk about security that has been reinforced in Batibo as a search for the missing divisional officer for the said locality as well as the social affairs delegate in the northwest region of Cameroon intensifies. It is one of the fallouts of yesterday's crisis meeting in the locality that was chaired by the senior divisional officer for Momo. The circulation of motorbikes has been strictly restricted in several parts of Batibo. As we speak, the measure to authorities is to limit the rate in several parts of Batibo. As we speak, the measure to authorities is to limit the rate of attacks, and fury is the word to describe the state of minds of local inhabitants that actually spoke to Equinox TV's team of reporters that were on the ground. We saw how local inhabitants were simply Capital Yaoundé, but the meeting was simply boycotted by some of the teachers. It was within the context of the seventh ordinary session, or the seventh session of the Interministerial Committee charged with examining and proposing solutions to the problems of the teachers who have been without salaries for several years now. During the meeting, the teachers' trade unions maintained that at least the government should ensure that the 300 teachers arrested on the day one of the protest should be released before the deliberations can begin. The union leaders said that the teachers must be released before the deliberations continue. Some have criticized the fact that the committee's six previous sessions are not yet yielding fruit up to now. It should be noted that the dozens of the striking secondary education teachers were arrested yesterday as they were striking against the accumulated salary arrears. Three of 300 of them were arrested, according to some of the teachers that met during the meeting today in the nation's capital. Few of the teachers continued the strike action that was today in front of the Ministry of Finance, the Secondary Education Ministry, and also in front of the Ministry of Employment and Vocational Training. And it was as a result of protest that some activists of the Anglophone problem were arrested. That was several months ago in the northwest and the southwest regions of Cameroon. Manchu BBC and other detainees of the Anglophone crisis that are due to appear in court tomorrow in the nation's capital were the case beating them. And the state of Cameroon is due to resume. The information was confirmed today by one of the lawyers defending the Anglophone activists who have been behind bars since the start of the socio-political unrest rocking the two Anglophone regions of Cameroon. The case has suffered countless adjournments after the release of the 55 persons arrested earlier in 2017, including Barrister Akbobala, Dr. Fontem Neba, and Aya Polabine. One of the preconditions for the return to normalcy in Anglophone regions of Cameroon is for the release or is the release of all those that have so far been arrested in connection with the crisis. Would Manchu BBC and Co. Finally have their verdict tomorrow? The answers only tomorrow's court hearing would tell. We now talk about the situation tomorrow's court hearing would tell. We now talk about the situation of journalists in the northwest region of Cameroon practicing journalism in that part of the country and also in the southwest region is now a veritable nightmare, an uphill task, but more than a nightmare and equally a very dangerous activity. This is because of the worsening socio-political and security situation in the two Anglophone regions of Cameroon. Journalists are permanently at risk of being attacked. We spoke to two journalists in the northwest region of Cameroon, Chove Lo and Emmanuel Fokum. They are going to be recounting their day-to-day ordeals in the following excerpt.
Normally, when you operate in a crisis zone, it will necessarily have an impact on your performance, meaning that it's sometimes very difficult to get to your sources because of declared ghost towns, because of fear, and so news gathering becomes not the best thing. Sometimes you work very often using the phone calls, or you have to sneak through the quarters to get to your sources
indoors. And they were complaining about the situation of security in Batibo at this point in time. It is as a result of the current socio-political crisis rocking the two Anglophone regions of Cameroon, as we see in the following report. Batibo is one of the subdivisions in Momo. It is located 40 kilometers from Bamenda and about 100 miles east of Nigeria. It is also situated along the Bamenda-Manfi Highway and known as the economic, social, political and cultural heartbeat of the Mogamo speaking people. This is the area where two administrators have in 2 weeks been picked up by unknown armed individuals and taken to an undisclosed destination. In Batibo, life has not been the same again for the population since the kidnapping of the divisional officer for the said locality on the 11th of February and the escalation of the Anglophone crisis. During a tour through the neighborhoods, doors were closed even in the afternoon and the streets were empty. Only few persons could be spotted.
The wrong go seeing that thing they start now where they be tip, they can't take D for fee for 11 February. Since that day they be taken, so people they and then they be there for your army, then they be there for you. So all picking, they run them. Now all of you should on. So we should also wait. So all picking, they run them. Now all of you should on. So we should also wait. No, do we?
This grandmother explains that her son fled the village for safety. She and other locals further recounted how their economic and social activities have crumbled as a result of the prevailing situation.
You know the chop flop, you know if you be steady for place, you want to do something. You so the run, you know what you have. You must fear. So therefore, you have no way for you to manage the knife set. What day? We know day we would go buy tea for the ghost time for chop, we begin there. And how we would me and my banya, we must around die. You know gay brother and sister. Now all we will take compound.
a palaver money, you know they get with money.
They are the only Batibo-based residents who accepted to talk to Equinox TV's team of reporters. Their desire is for the return to normalcy in the area and in the entire northwest region of Cameroon. To the administrators, the tension would have been minimized if the population worked in close collaboration with forces of law and order.
They feel how they many people they come, they should shoot that gun, they want to shoot and so they say they don't want to see a boy picking. No, do her. They gave for run. If now you see gun, they should show so you should run. As they told, they say they want a man picking them. Come for some mommy where they for us where it passed me, sir. Because mom will be put up for basket for move and biting that they move on.
But the fuel in this part of the northwest region of Cameroon is general.
We now talk about activities ahead of the 8th of March.
In fact, it's not been helping. The crisis have not been helping matters. We are caught between the web of the pros and the cons. We are in a situation where a journalist is supposed to be truthful. It's supposed to present the facts as they are. But we are in a situation where, in a political situation, I know that since politics is not about straight lines, politics is about crooked lines. To me, that politics is not about straight facts. In which case, somebody is saying something, somebody is objecting, and nobody is presenting the facts as they are. And if you find yourself in a situation where the sources are scary, the sources themselves are not, don't want to speak to the press, but the press has to report, the press has to entertain, it has to inform, and has to educate. So what many you just get to do with your, the inspiration of your training, you have to inform, and has to educate. So what many you just get to do with your, the inspiration of your training as a journalist to decipher what to tell the public. So it is more about experience here. And experience will indicate that at one moment you should use stock information to inform. Because when you go one way, you are attacked for being for, and one way you are attacked for being against, and at the end of the day you are caught up in the web, which makes reporting very difficult in times like this.
It is not actually easy because before you even get to report as a reporter, many people now with the Android phone and with the social media, they have already had what they have. And when you are coming now as a journalist who is bound now to give the truth, and to give what you have investigated, people want to judge you from what they are getting from the social media. So it is not easy as a reporter during this crisis. And you are even targeted when you want to give them the truth. They want you to take what they want and what they have heard or read or seen from the social media, which makes the work very difficult.
The difficulties of media practitioners in the northwest region of Cameroon in the wake of the socio-political crisis rocking the two Anglophone regions of the country. Now, would the Women's Day celebration be different for women of Binshua community based in the southwest region of Cameroon after the previous edition was affected by the Anglophone crisis? This, as they have so far been told to be agents of peace and unity in the entire society. The message was re-echoed by Barrister John Kamini as he was donating Women's Day fabric to some of the women. Westerly Derek Jato was there. He tells us more in this report.
The 2018 Women's Day built up in Buya subdivision.
If I have my bottle of drink, I will take it peacefully with a joyful day. If I have my bottle of drink, I will take it peacefully with a joyful day, with a joyful heart. On Women's Day, I'm feeling so happy. I'm very, very happy.
These women are from Binshua, a village in Donga Mantun division, resident in Buya subdivision. A subdivision that has known no peace for over 1 year now because of the Anglophone crisis. And today, Komfo Barrister John Kamani, a son of Binshua village, is preaching for the peace to come back through women.
Most of the women back home are encouraging their children to be disciplined. It's in that light that I thought that I should encourage them, thank them, and give them a strong push because they are the backbone of the modern.